Hey, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the first meeting of 2016 of the Public Petitions Committee. I haven't seen any colleagues, so happy new year.
Once more with feeling, yes.
It might be the last time I see it now. We've received apologies this morning from John Wilson, who told me that he has another event that he has to be at this morning, which brings us to agenda item one. The first item of business is to seek the committee's agreement to take agenda item four on witness expenses in private. Do members agree?
Yeah, agreed.
And that brings us to our next item of business, which is consideration of three new petitions, two of which we will take evidence on from the petitioners. The first is PE1592 by Shaheen McQuade on Group B Strep information and testing. Members have a note from the clerk. They have the petition, they have spice briefings and submissions from Shaheen herself. So I welcome Shaheen to the committee this morning. She's accompanied today by Craig Blackie, and I invite Shaheen to speak to her petition, and then we'll discuss the issues that you raise. Over to you, Shaheen.
Okay. This is my son, Zach. He's the reason I'm here today. I'm here today to explain my reasons for setting up my petition to raise awareness and better testing for Group B Strep. I discovered I was pregnant in December 2014. My fiancé, Craig, and I were delighted. At the time, we were both smokers and drank alcohol occasionally. As soon as I discovered I was pregnant, we both stopped smoking and gave up alcohol in order to give our baby a healthy start in life. In addition to this, I researched all foods that are harmful to unborn babies and also took pregnancy vitamins. I did all of this to protect my unborn baby and give him the best possible start. I had a trouble-free pregnancy and worked until I was 8.5 months pregnant without even a single day off due to any sickness. My waters broke while I was at home, and I informed a hospital who advised me to go over to be checked, which I did. The midwife advised me she wouldn't bother swabbing me as she could see that my waters had broke. I was sent home, and after only a couple of hours, my contractions started. I went back to the hospital and was told I was in labour, and 8.5 hours later, I gave birth to my beautiful, healthy son, Zach. We were kept in overnight and left home the following day. For the next 2 weeks, my son continued to grow into a happy, healthy, content baby. I couldn't believe how lucky I was, as he never cried, other than when I changed him or he was hungry. My family and friends were amazed at how often he smiled, as newborn babies tend to just sleep. My health visitor also commented on how she had never seen a healthier baby. On the 14th of August, when Zach was 12 days old, he was unsettled, which is unusual for him. Over the next few hours, he became worse, so I called an ambulance. He was rushed to hospital with a high temperature, and the doctors worked frantically on him. A few hours later, Craig and I were given devastating news that Zach had bacterial meningitis and that he probably would not survive. He was then transferred to York Hill Hospital and sadly passed away on the 15th at 3 p.m. I can't begin to tell you how heartbroken Craig and I are, and also our immediate families. Zach's the first grandson in Craig's family and the first grandchild for my parents. In a follow-up meeting with the consultants at York Hill, I was horrified to discover that Zach had developed meningitis due to contracting Group B Strep during labour. I had never heard of Group B Strep, and at no point during pregnancy or labour was it discussed or tested for.
Just take your time.
I since discovered that Group B Strep can be identified by carrying out a simple swab test, which I understand costs £11. Had I been tested after my waters breaking, I would have been given antibiotics, which would have almost certainly prevented the risk of my baby contracting Group B Strep. I have also read the National Screening Committee's previous report in 2012, where it was decided not to screen all pregnant women for Group B Strep, but would use the risk-based strategy to decide who should be tested. They will only test women if they are shown symptoms like protein in urine, waters breaking early and a high temperature in labour, all signs I had but were never picked up on. Therefore, does this not suggest this approach is not working and needs to be changed immediately? Part of the reason is that the test is not 100% reliable. Then why are they not setting aside funding to produce a more reliable test. This also suggests to me that it is more of a let's just take a chance attitude, a decision that cost my son his life. It cost me and Craig our future. It denied our parents and families the love of their grandson and nephew. Millions of pounds are spent educating women on the dangers of smoking and alcohol during pregnancy, all of which I took very seriously and ensured I didn't do. The NHS didn't do the same for my son. Zach was not given the right to live. I've been denied the right to have my son in my life and watch him grow up. But instead, I have been sentenced to a lifetime of heartache. To lose a baby is devastating. To know it could have been prevented is torture. This has to change.
Thank you. Shaheen, can I thank you very much for giving your evidence? It's very courageous of you. And I extend on behalf of the committee our sincerest condolences at the loss of your child. I know you've worked very hard with organisations that have looked into this, and this committee itself has looked at this issue before. And we were given the same information, that there's a review taking place, that there's investigations taking place. When we closed the petition that was before us in 2014-15, it was because we were expecting a report to come in front of us, and the timescale for that might have been around 18 months. But in that time, you've had the tragedy that's befallen you and your family for the sake of £11. But you also said in your evidence that the signs that they look for, which would have indicated a need to give you an antibiotic, were there.
Yep.
So either yourself or on behalf of the organisations that you've been working with, what's your view on this decision not to test people or inform people that there is a test available?
In my opinion, I think it's neglect. The NHS took a gamble with my son's life and they lost. I showed the symptoms of Group B Strep. At the time, I didn't know what Group B Strep was. I didn't know what these signs were for. And my son then picked it up. And nothing, there was nothing that could have been done once it had already triggered inside him. Because he had no immune system. He was only 12 days old. His body was too small to fight the infection. And he lost his life because of it.
Yeah. In the investigations that you've done since the tragedy, do you think that the staff who were there, and I'm sure did a very good job, and I've never heard you complaining about the way that you were treated by the staff, but do you think the staff were aware that they should have been looking for those signs in order to check that something needed to be done if it was necessary?
But the NHS work on the risk-based strategy. When a woman is shown these symptoms, then she should be tested. I think that I should have been tested, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I've been trying to arrange a meeting with the midwives to talk to them about my care from when my waters broke until me and Zach were let home from the hospital.
Yeah. Okay, I'll open up to other members of the committee who might want to ask questions.
Thank you for your evidence, and also you've touched on my heart as well, that you know the suffering that you and your family have gone through. It's the point that you're trying to make. I'm just wanting to make sure that I pick this up correctly, is that you would like to see this done automatically, simply because staff members tend not to pick it up.
Yes.
And you just don't want, you want to make sure that nobody else has the same suffering that you've had to go through.
Yes, I don't want any other parents to and families to have to suffer what we've had to go through.
Now, I don't know what the NHS's position would be on that, with the exception of the fact that there's a financial implication. But I would tend to agree with you in terms of it's a very, very small price to pay for such a huge difference that would make to people's lives and quality of life.
I did, I'm not the greatest mathematician in the world, but I don't think it takes a genius to work out. It was around 55,000 births in Scotland last year at £11 per birth. If not every mother takes the opportunity to have the test, it's still a figure of between 500,000 to 600,000, which could be spent to save a number of lives.
Yeah.
Do you think that's a price worth paying?
Definitely. If you calculate how £11 compared to the cost of Zach's care when he was took to hospital, from ambulances to brain monitoring equipment, all the antibiotics he was on, the trip from Wisher General to York Hill Hospital, the brain scans, all that calculated compared to £11,
yeah,
it would actually save the NHS money.
Yeah. Anyone else want to? Angus.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I notice from a briefing that we have that there were parliamentary questions asked on the 19th of November last year by Jim Hume, MSP, who received a response from the Scottish Government, who said there was currently no recommended test for Group B streptococcus that would be suitable for routine antenatal screening. So, as a result of that, no cost-benefit analysis had been undertaken by the Scottish Government. But in a further section that we've received, it states that the Scottish Government already refers to Group B streptococcus in the Ready Steady Baby booklet, and that that's currently been reviewed, and a revised section is due to be published at the end of this month, it says. Did you receive that booklet and
no,
never got it?
After Zach passed away, I'd got in touch with the Group B Strep support group, and they advised me that they had, I think it was Jackie Watt, had brought a petition to yourselves back in 2014, and that was to get more information in the Ready Steady Baby booklet. I'd never heard of that. I was never given that by, as far as I know, it's an online booklet. I was never given that from my midwife.
Okay, and it was never referred to?
No.
Right. Which health board are you in? Which health board covers your area?
NHS
Lanarkshire.
Yeah,
right. Okay. Thanks.
Can I come back? I mean, I know we're talking about figures and costs, but I don't think that's relevant for this committee to worry about the costs. I think if we carry out more tests, I think the costs would reduce anyway. But more importantly, the issue really here is we need to try and pick up people who are vulnerable from this, and that's the most important thing. Now, if it's on a checklist, then it's going to get done. If it's not on any checklist, it's not going to get done. And clearly, it wasn't done, even though the patient needed to receive the medication. So, I think it's an issue about what checklists are available, and who does that work, and we need to make sure that that's actually in place. And in terms of costs, I mean, we spend billions on so many other things. We talk about life, you know, so I don't think cost is relevant, to be honest.
Yeah. Any other questions from? No. I'm looking for suggestions now to how we take it forward, Jackson.
Convener, I do think there is, from the briefing we've received, a long track record within this committee and within Parliament throughout the lifetime of this session of Parliament of raising this issue with government. And when you look at the kind of collected tone of response, it does seem to be underpinned by a lack of urgency to actually find a way forward. I think, therefore, that we should write to the Scottish Government, but with some specific commentary, not just to ask for the reaction to the petition. I'm interested in two points that have been made by the petitioner. Firstly, I would like to know how the Ready Steady Baby booklet is made available. The minute you say booklet, it implies to me that there is, in fact, a publication that is handed along with some sort of advice. Clearly, that wasn't the case. So if it does exist online, who is responsible for directing potential parents' attention to that? And is there any knowledge or evidence as to what the uptake of accessing that publication is, or any follow-up to establish whether that's taken place. And I secondly think that the powerful testimony of our witness, and it is difficult to incorporate this, but I would like to see it done, that yes, there was a tremendous personal loss in the death of their son, Zach, but there was also a financial cost, which I think the petitioner detailed, which, of course, it's very easy to set to one side when you're, as you say, talking about somebody saying, well, it's £500,000, we don't know. Clearly, we're now at the end of the lifetime of this Parliament, so it's difficult to start talking about scheduling evidence sessions with ministers and anything like that now. So I think we want a very direct letter saying that it's clear this has gone on for some time, but we haven't really, I think, advanced matters. And to keep being told there's a review and it might and it could seems to me to be falling short of a problem that we could actually, with a bit of will behind the effort, do something to resolve.
No, I think that's certainly my feeling. For the record, Shaheen is my constituent, and I've met with Shaheen to talk to her about the circumstances, and she's well versed in the arguments around this. And one of the strongest arguments, I think, is the fact that this is done in other countries, and it's been proven to be successful in other countries. And why we appear to be, in the vernacular, swinging the lead, when it comes to actually making progress on this, hiding behind arguments that there isn't a particularly good test. Well, let's find the test. Let's invest in the money to get the test so that we can make sure that it works properly. Secondly, are we investing enough in training so that staff can identify that when there are signs that there should be a test done and an antibiotic administered, then people are adequately aware that that should happen. So we have to make sure that action is taken on this, because while we've been waiting on a review taking place, Shaheen and I'm no doubt other people have suffered the tragic loss of their child when it could have been avoided. And if this committee says anything at all, we should say that that's not acceptable. So I think we should write to the government and ask them to ask what action they are going to take this forward, because we can't sit any longer waiting on reviews. We need to see what definitive action is going to be taken. Take the evidence if it's required from other countries and make sure that we do what they do, because it's working in those other countries and should be able to be made to work here. Is that agreed? Angus?
Yeah, just on that, convener, given that you have mentioned that it is working in other countries, could we, given that the petition will remain live, can we get some more information from SPICE with regard to which countries
I think we should do that.
It is operating
just to back it up, yeah. Okay. Again, Shaheen, thank you very much for coming along. As I said, you and Craig have suffered a terrible loss, and it's very courageous of you to use your own personal experience to try and help other people, but we do appreciate the fact that you've done that, and thank you very much for coming before us this morning.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'll suspend the committee for a couple of minutes. Do we change witnesses? Our next petition this morning is PE1593 by Paul Quigley on behalf of Fans Against Criminalisation on a full review of the Offensive Behaviour at Football and Threatening Communication Scotland Act 2012. Members have a note from the clerk, the petition itself, a spice briefing and submission from the petitioner. I welcome Graham Pearson and James Kelly to the committee. We also expect to be joined by Paul Martin and Jackie Bailey, but Jackie Bailey has also sent a letter to the committee, as has Cara Hilton, expressing their support. John Wilson, who couldn't join us this morning as a member of the committee, also sent me an email when he was making his apologies to say that he is supportive of the terms of this petition. So I'll pass over to yourself, Mr. Quigley. You have a few minutes to introduce the petition, and then we'll discuss what you raise with us.
Over right, okay. So thank you very much, Michael, for the introduction, and thanks very much to you all for having us here to discuss the petition and share our concerns about the Offensive Behaviour at Football Act. I'll give a very quick overview of who we are and who we are here to represent. We are members of Fans Against Criminalisation, a protest group that began in 2011 to oppose the introduction of the Offensive Behaviour at Football Act, and we've since campaigned against it whilst also trying to help people who have perhaps been charged under it whilst collating their own evidence in regards to those cases. First of all as well, I'll make a very quick point that our petition and the reason that we are here today isn't at all to defend sectarianism. We are not here to defend any hate crime, but we would note that sectarian behaviour, racist behaviour, homophobia, sexism was all actually covered under previous legislation. Our contention with this act is more in regards to the offensive behaviour clause that's factored within it. What that ultimately means is that it creates a new law which criminalises offensiveness. Now, the difficulty in that is that offensiveness is obviously subjective. What members of the committee might find offensive, I might not, and vice versa. So it becomes almost practically impossible to police, and as a result, there becomes a broadening blurring of what is legally acceptable. So the impact of that is at football matches, is that young men and girls primarily are being arrested and dragged through the courts. The Stirling report, for example, showed that court cases go on far longer than normal court cases, but the conviction rate remains shockingly low, and people's lives are ultimately ruined in the process. So in terms of the law itself, what we object to is the fact that it specifically discriminates against football fans. It creates a law which only applies to one demonised sector of society. And we disagree with that on that basis as well. The reason for the petition, though, rather specifically, is that we feel that the Scottish Government have reneged on their promise to review the Act, which they fully review the Act anyway, which should have been done in 2015. What was put through as the review was a consideration of one piece of evidence in terms of a report carried out by the University of Stirling, which we would contend was selectively quoted. For example, it wasn't mentioned when that was published that within that piece of research, it showed that, for example, because so many resources had been diverted towards policing offensiveness, that there was actually a rise, for example, in violence at football games. It showed that many judges had very key concerns about human rights implications of the Act because of the curtailment of freedom of speech and also the curtailment of political expression. And these are the issues that we feel still have to be properly reviewed. The other piece of evidence was an opinion poll that was carried out by YouGov that we felt was somewhat skewed as well. When the Act was initially put through in 2011, there was an attempt to rush it through as emergency legislation, and the then First Minister stated that he wished to build a consensus around the Act. But, you know, we're over 5 years on since that particular point, and the consensus of opposition is all that remains. Every single opposition party, including independents, voted against the Act at the time, and as far as I'm aware, none of their positions on that matter have changed. there still remains concern from lawyers, judges, civil rights groups, football fans and football clubs themselves. The problem is that these people haven't been given ample opportunity to actually present their evidence in any sort of review process against this act. All we've heard is one side of it. Given that the controversy surrounding the act continues, given that the incredibly low conviction rate demonstrates that the act isn't working, we feel that now is the point, that it's clearly in the public interest for us to have a full review of the act and allow the different stakeholders to have their opportunity to input in the process. And obviously we would want to be a part of that with a view to having it repealed ultimately.
Okay, thanks very much, Paul, for introducing your petition. I'll start off by asking a question about the understanding of the way that the Act has been implemented. FAC were set up at the outset, and a lot of the media coverage and the general discussion around this is that this is an issue that relates to Celtic and Rangers. But my understanding is that as time has gone on, more and more football fans groups have either joined or supported the FAC campaign. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is correct. I mean, what I would say as well is that even at the start, there were protests held by fans in stadiums all across the country. For example, Celtic fans, Rangers fans, even the Scottish national team, Motherwell, Hearts, Hibs, all held demonstrations against the act in the stadium. More recently, what we've seen is a bit of an upsurge in terms of other fans taking more of a noted interest in it, particularly Hamilton and Motherwell. Their fans have been subject to quite disgraceful behaviour as a result of this act. And we've had those two groups of fans, as well as Rangers fans, begin to join our campaign against it. So it's not about, as I say, it's not about Celtic and Rangers, but it's not about sectarianism either. It's something that affects all football supporters, and that's why we've got it here today.
Yeah. We've also talked about the reason why the Act was introduced, but recently, as recently as yesterday, there's been motions put down in the Scottish Parliament by MSPs who have tried to explain the rationale for this legislation as being somehow to try and protect the Irish community and the Catholic community from sectarianism and offensive behaviour. Does FAC have an opinion on that? Jeanette, do you want to answer that?
Yeah, could I please? That proposal was put forward by John Mason MSP, and John Mason has repeatedly made this claim that this legislation was primarily about defending Catholics and the Irish community against abuse. Now, he's the only person, as far as I'm aware, in the entire country and the entire Parliament who's making that claim. And he makes that claim on the basis of, as far as I understand it, no evidence whatsoever. So, in a sense, we're at a loss to understand how he can make the claim, why he continues to repeat it. But also, I'm not aware of any Catholic organisation, including the Catholic Church, or any Irish community organisation who agrees with that, who agrees with the legislation, who has asked for that protection. We are indeed, and I speak not as FAC here, but as a member of the Irish community, as a Catholic, we are indeed primarily the victims of sectarianism and racism. And the most recent figures show a 14% rise in offences against other whites, which I believe are the Irish and the Polish. So it's not to say that that is not an issue, but we simply do not see and do not agree that this legislation in any way contributes to resolving that particular problem.
Yeah. In your opening comments, Paul, you mentioned the interpretation that had been put on the research that had been done by the Scottish Government. And when the Scottish Government reported to Parliament some months ago, a claim was made by the Minister, Paul Wheelhouse, that in discussions with yourselves you had endorsed and supported elements of the action that the Scottish Government were taking, in particular in terms of rehabilitation. Could you clarify exactly what discussions took place and what your view is on that?
Well, what I'll do is I'll pass that over to Jeanette, if you don't mind, because I wasn't actually at the meeting with Paul Wheelhouse, so I'll pass that over to Jeanette. Yeah.
Yeah, we did have a meeting with Paul Wheelhouse before the ministerial statement was made, some weeks before, maybe a fortnight, as I recall. And we made it very clear that we were entirely opposed to the Act. And as part of that, we pointed out that it was primarily criminalising young men who otherwise would have no contact with the criminal justice system. We certainly did point that out. Mr. Wheelhouse, as I recall, specifically asked us, would we then assist him in, you know, spreading the message to young people to divert them from this criminal activity. We pointed out that we were completely unable to do that since we did not think that what they were alleged to have done amounted to criminal activity. We rejected the idea that that singing a song in support of Irish independence was in itself, for instance, as an example, was in itself, or wearing a T-shirt that called for a free Palestine was in itself a criminal offence. So we would be unable to call for young people to desist from doing that. When he made the statement that we supported his diversion from prosecution scheme, that was entirely a false statement, and we had made it clear to one of his advisers, because we'd been advised that he was going to make this statement, and immediately prior to that meeting we told Mr. Wheelhouse's adviser that he should not make that statement because we did not support the scheme. He went ahead and made the statement. We thereafter wrote to Mr. Wheelhouse and said, you've made the statement. We told your adviser we did not support it. At no time did we say we supported it. Please retract the statement that we support your scheme. And he failed to do so.
Okay. You've researched a lot into legislation and the types of legislation that are enacted around this issue. And there have been reviews of legislation that have taken place before. Have you done any analysis of the type of review that normally accompanies legislation when it has to be reviewed, and have you compared it to what has been claimed as a review in terms of the Offensive Behaviour Act?
I don't think we would have any specific examples of any of the types of legislation that might have been previously reviewed. Our understanding would have been that it would have been at least similar to the initial process when the Act was brought in, which allowed for various stakeholders to submit their evidence, and some people were invited along to the Justice Committee who dealt with the Act when it was first being pushed through. Now, our understanding was, at the very least, we would have an opportunity to air our concerns, given that we've been the primary opposition to this Act over the last 4 years. We've been quite vocally opposed to it. We've also collated quite a bit of our own evidence, and we assumed that we would have the opportunity to submit that in some form. Obviously, we weren't given that opportunity, and given the amount of opposition, given the amount of stakeholders who remain opposed to this Act, we feel that some form of a review that would allow them to submit their own evidence would give a more all-encompassing picture of what this Act does, as opposed to just taking it from one piece of evidence, as the review did in 2015.
Okay. I think it's also important to note that the single piece of evidence which the government relied on, the authors issued a statement, two statements in fact at the time, saying that this, whatever they were doing, it was not the review. It was an evaluation which they understood would inform and contribute to a review, but it was not itself the review. So they were making it clear that what they were about was not reviewing the Act. In fact, they very specifically say that the evidence that they provide is not either in support or in opposition to the Act. It was simply reviewing all of the evidence around it as instructed by, as commissioned by the Scottish Government. But even if the Scottish Government had relied solely on that piece of evidence in its entirety, they would have been pointing out things like the fact that Paul has already pointed out that the police themselves gave evidence that, in fact, they're concerned that while they're policing and putting resources into offensiveness, violence has taken place, violence which has been on a long-term decline is starting to pick up a little bit, away from football grounds, not at football grounds, but they're unable to police that because they're policing offensiveness. They would have been able to point out how few successful prosecutions, that was also in the report. They would have been able to point out how sheriff's views are very, there's very strong opposition views, some in favour. Most of the ones who are in favour of the alleged objectives of the Act, as opposed to how the Act has actually been framed and implemented. They would have been able to point out that sheriffs are really concerned about the question of what constitutes offensiveness. They would have been able to point out that in actual fact, when they surveyed stakeholders and asked what it is that they, what kind of offensiveness they actually observed or experienced, the overwhelming majority was swearing at opposition players and management, followed by swearing at opposition fans. So in fact, when you ask football fans, what offensiveness are you encountering, what the Stirling research showed was it's swearing.
Okay. Before I open up to the committee, just one other point. I mean, have you spoken to people who were interviewed by Stirling University in relation to the review and their awareness of what was actually being undertaken?
Yeah, I mean, our understanding of it is that they didn't think that that was going to be the review of the Act. As Jeanette said, Stirling University actually published statements on their website to specifically note that this wasn't to be taken as a review of the success of the Act. We did meet with the interviewers prior to the this being released as a review, and they certainly noted to us that this wasn't the review, and they weren't particularly sure how it would be carried out. But even at that point, it seemed to be their opinion as well that that would serve to inform the review as opposed to actually make up the entirety of the review.
The team did not interview FAC formally as part of the process until after the interim report had been produced, and they indicated that that somebody from the team had spoken to me. That did happen very early on, but it was as part of my professional role, and I was never told that I was being interviewed or spoken to in relation to a piece of research which was commissioned by the government. So I had a discussion with a research student who it turned out was part of the team, but she did not indicate to me at that time that this would be part of it. And then later on, they relied on that as being the fact that they had spoken to FAC, but they did not. We did ultimately, in the end, have some discussion with them, but it was after the interim report was produced.
Yeah. Just for the record, I was also interviewed by Stirling University's team. I was not told in advance of the interview what the purpose of the interview was, and only discovered later that I had been interviewed as part of that team in the information that then became what has been called the review. So they're clearly, at the time that this was this piece of academic work was being pursued, it did not relate to a review of the legislation. And I'm not saying I felt as well I was conned in any way. The answers I gave are the same answers I would have given if I'd known in advance. But the fact is, I did not know until after the interview that what I had taken part in was what subsequently became called the Scottish Government's review of the Act, and I just don't believe that that's a particularly good way to conduct the business. But I'll open up to members of the committee to comment on the points that have been raised. Jackson.
Thank you, Convener. Surprisingly, only the devolved parliament in Switzerland has written into its articles a statutory obligation to conduct post-legislative scrutiny of the legislation it passes. And although there is an opportunity in this parliament, actually very little legislation is scrutinised. Consequently, I've come to the view that that should become much more apparent in the face of many of our bills. And therefore, I'm supportive of the aim to undertake a review of the petition. But I should say, having agreed to that proposition, I haven't necessarily prejudged what the outcome of that review would be. So, whereas you say that you would want it specifically to direct to an objective, I mean, I would support the idea in principle, because I think that it's a healthy thing for parliaments to do, particularly on legislation which is designed to change social attitude. But I've got two specific questions which I'm interested to see if you can help me with. You refer to the 22% conviction rate. Of those 22%, what were the worst offences and what was the sentence that was received on conviction? Do you know?
It's not possible from the government figures to answer that question very directly, but I'll do as best as I can. The 22% is not a figure that the government support quote. What that is taking all of the charges in the period, the lifetime of the Act, so it's across the whole period of the Act, and the number of convictions and showing one is a proportion of the other. We've had discussions with the statisticians who work on this, and what the government quote is conviction rates are not actually conviction rates as we would understand them, which would say in any one period how many people have been charged and what proportion of those have been convicted, because, as Paul has already pointed out, the time frame that it takes for a case to go through the courts does not correspond with the reporting period of the stats. So that's a complicated way round of saying the statistics which the government quote are low, but in fact they're even lower because it's the more difficult cases and the ones that are likely to be found not guilty that actually take the longest. So we're saying they're 22%.
But
if you say what are the worst offences, yeah, they're divided up. The government statistics are divided up in terms of the various elements that are mentioned in the Act. So there are things like, is it homophobia, is it racism, is it whatever it might be. And then there's an other category. And the other category is, as I understand it, generally held to be support for what they call terrorist organisations. So that's the other category. That, as we understand it, is the only set of behaviours which would not otherwise have been covered by existing legislation. It's quite a small part. It's about, I think, in the last set of figures, or the one before last, 17%. So it's not the majority. The majority of offences, or you know, the majority of behaviours for which people are charged, these are not convictions, these are charges, are the things that they could have been charged with under existing legislation. So racism, homophobia, all of those kinds of things which could have been charged under potentially breach of the peace with Section 74, you know, religious aggravation or those other types of charges. In terms of the sentences that people get, well, they range from, there have been, I think, only two prison sentences.
Yeah, not many.
I think there's been two prison sentences very early on. The rest of them are community service orders, sometimes football banning orders, and that type of thing.
Okay.
In a number of cases, there have been absolute discharges, no sentence whatsoever.
The only other thing that I would like to add to that is just when you referred to the others, that would also likely include the, as you spoke about swearing, which is what, yes, fundamentally what, you know, there was quite a lot of Motherwell and Hamilton fans who were jailed at a derby match for swearing at opposition fans. So those kind of things that might happen that clubs out with Celtic and Rangers, that would come into the other category as well.
I think so. Can I just very quickly add, I think it's helpful for members of the committee to understand precisely what we mean by this. The two Motherwell fans that we're referring to are 18-year-olds who were chanting, "Well, well, F your well," I won't say the full word, and were held from, it was a Friday night game, the Monday was a bank holiday, they were held in Greenock Prison, not in a police cell, they were held in Greenock Prison from Monday night to Tuesday morning and charged under the Offensive Behaviour Act for something that I think most of us would have thought merited no more than saying, "Come on, boys, mind your language."
Okay, thank you for that. That was comprehensive and very interesting. And it does suggest a slight lack of clarity in all of that too. My only other question is, you're here representing fans against criminalisation. And the slight worry I sometimes have is that things get rolled into a large basket of anecdotal evidence and it was said by, and I've heard that. And I'm interested to know, as individuals, what direct personal experience you have had of the Act.
I want to go first.
Well, I think what you've seen is a complete change in the culture of policing and the way that football fans are treated going into a football match. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that someone has to be dragged out of a stand or dragged out of their bed and for going into a police station to feel the effects of the act. What you're seeing is an increased police presence most of the time, which is entirely unjustifiable. You know, we've had situations whereby, or I've certainly had situations whereby you're filmed from the moment that you got off the bus, the supporters' bus, at whatever ground it might be across the country, all throughout the game and then all afterwards. You're stopped and searched. I had a situation whereby Celtic played a team called Rennes in France in 2000. Was it? I can't quite remember when it was. But what happened? This was when the act was coming into play. There was an increased police presence, and I was standing in the square in Rennes with Celtic fans, and a police officer came up and asked, "How are you doing, Paul? How are you getting on at university?" And it seemed like a direct attempt to intimidate me, to show that they had collated this evidence or that this information about me, and that it was almost this officer saying, "We're keeping an eye on you. You better watch that you behave yourself." In spite of the fact that, you know, I hadn't ever been in trouble with the police, hadn't ever you know, found myself charged or arrested or anything of that nature. But from my own experience, it pales in significance when you compare it to what other people have faced. And I'm sure Jeanette can fill in about some of the direct things that we've faced when trying to protest the act, for example, at the SNP party conference in Aberdeen. So I'll let her fill in about that.
Okay. In terms of our direct experience, like Paul, I have neither been charged or under this act or indeed any other act. As you can quite clearly see, I'm a middle-aged woman. I travel to the football with other people, some of whom are sitting behind me and some of whom, they won't mind me saying, are even a bit older than me. And I find myself in that context, whereas in no other context in my life am I treated in the way that I'm treated as a football fan. Because as soon as I become a football fan, I am filmed, I'm stared at, I'm searched. I was travelling on Sunday and the bus was searched, you know, twice. The attitude of police officers, I think it's very dangerous. It's not going to provoke a reaction in me because that's not who I am, but I think it's intimidating, it's provocative, and the act has created a very poisonous, and this is the most dangerous thing, a very poisonous relationship between the police and young fans, and that's in nobody's interest. In terms of protesting against the act, Fans Against Criminalisation have, even there, this is not using the act, but using other legislation, we have been prevented from protesting, we have been intimidated while protesting, we've had at least 7 police complaints upheld. One of them, we went to Aberdeen to protest out quite legitimately to lobby outside the SNP spring conference. We were immediately served with a Section 12 notice under the Public Order Act. There was 19 of us there. There were other groups protesting, trade union groups and other groups, much larger numbers, had no difficulty whatsoever. We were served with a Public Order Act. Our age range that day went from 7 to 73. The police subsequently apologised and said that that should not have happened. We were followed from Glasgow to Aberdeen by people from the Football Intelligence Unit that day, despite the fact that there was no football match on that day, simply because we were going to protest against the act. We've had intimidated and harassed inside courtrooms when myself and another colleague go to take notes when offensive behaviour cases are being held. And I understand what you're saying about anecdotal evidence, but we are very carefully collecting evidence. We have a contact form and an information form on our site which we ask people to fill in. We follow up cases, we attend cases, we take very detailed notes, we analyse the government statistics. So I would like to think that while you could characterise what we're saying as anecdotal, it's no more anecdotal than collecting evidence from focus groups, which is what the Stirling evidence was. So yes, I can honestly say to you that as somebody who's followed football for, you know, decades, that before this act, I never noticed the police. They were clearly there. They were clearly carrying out their duties in terms of making sure people were safe. But if you asked me how many police were at a given game or what they were doing, I would have been unable to tell you because I don't remember ever paying any attention to them. And that is, it seems to me, how it should be. Since the Act or in the run-up to the Act, I now find myself that every game is almost an ordeal in terms of how the police conduct themselves.
OK, thank you both. Thank you, Convener.
Kenny, to follow by Angus.
Mr. Quigley. There are games now, even in the Premier League, in which there are no police present within the ground.
Yeah, I would assume there will be.
And would it not be the case that the majority of SPFL games have a very limited police presence driven because clubs have to pay for the cost?
Well, there will obviously be some games that will be deemed as a lesser risk. So there will be, yeah.
Do you accept that simply the level of convictions might not be the criteria to use, because that would apply also to rape and sexual offences if you wish to review or abandon?
No, because I think that would get entirely off topic. I think that when you look at more of the evidence which suggests, as I say, that cases drag on for much longer than other cases, that's what it says in the Stirling report, that it shows, because of the nature of the Act, it's very difficult to define what is offensiveness. As I've said, offensiveness is subjective. So if you're going to criminalise offensiveness, you're going to get, in my opinion, a low conviction rate. Now, we oppose the Act regardless of what the conviction rate is. We oppose the idea that these things are criminal. But the conviction rate simply serves to demonstrate that this Act isn't working.
Sorry, can I just throw in there that if conviction rates are not the correct things to be looking at, I think maybe you should direct that question to your own Community Safety Minister and the previous Community Safety Minister, who both relied on conviction rates in discussing this.
Can I also ask, in terms of, it used to historically be the case, and I think it still is, that Catholic officers within the RUC and within the PSNI were targeted for killing. Is that sectarian?
Sorry, don't see the evidence
on the offence. I was asking your question, Mr. Quigley. Is that a sectarian attack upon a Catholic officer within the PSNI?
No, I don't see how that's relevant at all to our petition.
I think it's a perfectly reasonable question to ask. Do you think it's a sectarian act to target an officer within the PSNI because he or she is Catholic?
It's a sectarian act to target anybody for anything because of their religion in a negative way. That's a sectarian act. But actually, we were handed these. We're committee witnesses to come to talk about a petition on the Offensive Behaviour Act. If you wish to discuss murder, then I think this is not what we were asked to come here and discuss, and you've now raised the issue of murder with us.
I think I've got the answer I wanted, Ms. Findlay, but I've still a few more questions, if you don't mind, Convener. Do you think that the mother of and the family of Ronan Kerr, and indeed other police families who have lost loved ones, might be distressed by what could be described as songs that venerate their killers?
What songs would that be?
What songs are you referring to?
Well, songs that venerate dissident Republican IRA.
Unless you can be specific about what songs you're referring to.
I've given you a specific question.
Well, you haven't.
Well, I have.
Is this a song that you know?
No.
Is there a song that you're referring to?
Well, it might not be a song. It could be a chant. It could be a statement. I will put the question to you, Mr. Quigley. Do you think that the families of the likes of Ronan Kerr, who lost a loved one because they were murdered for being a Catholic officer within the PSNI, could be distressed, upset, or indeed angered by chants or songs venerating their killers?
Well, first of all, I would say that, as far as I'm aware, no such song exists. But of course, if such a song were to be, then obviously the families or members of the families affected would be distressed by it, of course.
What about songs that venerate the killers of British soldiers?
Well, yes. Well, their families may also be distressed, yeah, of course.
I have no further questions.
What would you think of motions in the Scottish Parliament that urge commemoration of the Easter Rising, but would lead to you being arrested at a football match if you were to say the same thing?
Well, yeah, that's exactly it. What happens is, as a result of this act, people are basically being told that with the purchase of a match ticket, they lose their right to political expression. Now, it doesn't necessarily just relate to, I assume you're referring to the James Connolly issue, but obviously as well there has been an issue with Celtic fans attempting to be arrested for wearing Palestine T-shirts. For example, as well, John Mason has said that he feels that fans who wear Yes Scotland badges at football matches should be susceptible to police action. And it just demonstrates very clearly how difficult it becomes when you start trying to curtail freedom of speech and particularly freedom of political expression.
So, I mean, Mr McCaskill has raised this issue, and I think your reference there was to the, well, frankly, rank hypocrisy of anybody who can say that they wish to support a statue to somebody who took part in an armed uprising and may well have done, although I don't know what the historical evidence is, may well have killed a British soldier. And he wants a statue raised. He also wishes to commemorate, I think quite rightly, the 1916 uprising. Now, he's raising this because he thinks that somehow or another he's going to deflect for the fact that his own hypocrisy in saying that if we were to equally, or anybody, I don't say we, because I don't say that, you know, that I sing those songs at football grounds, but if anybody were to sing those songs at a football ground, commemorating exactly the same actions, exactly the same activities, that somehow or another that would be criminal, whereas Mr McCaskill's own views on this would not be criminal. And that, I don't think it's what he set out to do, but I think it sets out to this committee precisely the problem with this act, because it makes criminal actions for football fans which would not otherwise be criminal, and that cannot be right. It's certainly right that football fans should be subject to exactly the same laws as the rest of society, but they should not have actions made criminal which in other contexts and other places would not be criminal. That cannot be right. The expression of a view is the expression of a view, and quite frankly, people expressing views of all kinds, political and otherwise, at sporting events, is as long as politics and sports itself.
Okay, Angus. I'll let you come back in, Ken, if you want to come in later.
The point made by Ms Findlay, do you not accept, and the evidence has been given both by the current Lord Advocate, indeed previous ministers, that it's about context. It's what you do, where you do it, and how you do it. And making a political statement in a political gathering is one thing. Shouting something offensive at a crowd where people could be distressed is another. Is context not a factor?
Sorry, you've just jumped from making a statement at a political gathering to saying something offensive. Now, which is it we're talking about? Let me ask you a very specific question then, if that's what you're asking
I was asking the question.
Okay, let's go.
If you allow me to clarify the question, do you not accept that it's been made quite clear by indeed the Lord Advocate and the Appeal Court, that it's context?
The context of this act is that nobody needs to be there who is offended. Nobody even needs to know that such a statement took place in order for this still to be an offence under the act. So the context argument has been broadened to a point where it's absolutely impossible for sheriffs or anybody else to really make any sense of it. And anything said at any time on any subject, as long as it's in the context of a regulated football match, could fall foul of this act. Is that really the kind of legislation that you want to have in a modern Scotland?
Okay, Angus.
Okay, thanks, Convener. Maybe if I can touch on more general aspects of the petition, but perhaps before I do, can I say that having read the front page of the Glasgow Herald this morning, it perhaps doesn't do the argument that you're pushing today much good. Now, you state in your submission that...
Could you give us an indication? I haven't read the paper.
Sorry, well, it refers to Sunday's fourth round match at Stair Park in Stranraer, where there were some arrests.
Okay.
Now, you state in your submission that the Act is unjust and unworkable. I think that's the term that you've stated in the submission. Now, a recent analysis shows that there was a 28% drop in charges reported by the police to the Procurator Fiscal under Section 1 of the Act. And, of course, we've had the YouGov poll that you referred to earlier, and I think you referred to it as somewhat skewed, which was published in June last year, which highlighted that 80% directly support the Act, 82% believe that offensive behaviour at football matches is harmful, and 73% of respondents of those respondents said they were very interested in football directly support the Act. So with those statistics that show since the introduction of the Act, religious crimes are down, race crimes are down, crimes in relation to individual sexuality are down, and we've seen a decrease in crimes of offensive behaviour at or in relation to regulated football matches in Scotland, how can you say the Act hasn't delivered real improvements to date?
Sorry, can I just come in on a bit of that before Paul comes in? First of all, the YouGov poll does not say what you said it said. 1,044 people were interviewed. Over 55% of them had no interest or, in fact, more than no interest in football. So less than half of them had any real reason to understand how the Act operates. Of those, when they were asked, were they in favour of action against sectarianism? And they said yes. They said, thinking of this Act, given that it's intended to oppose sectarianism, do you support this Act? So frankly, if that's not a skewed question, I don't know what is. And
well,
I'm surprised the numbers were not
higher. 73% of the respondents who said they were very interested in football directly support the Act. That's fact.
No. They don't say they say they support the Act because the question is asked in terms of are you in favour of action against sectarianism. So it's predicated on the view that if this is action against sectarianism, do you support the Act? In which case they say yes, and I'm surprised it's only 73% because you would expect it to be higher if that was the case. However, so I don't think that we can really rely on that. In terms of what you said was a reduction in convictions, a reduction in charges. Now, the number of charges that take place is entirely within the gift of the police and the Procurator Fiscal Service. So in terms of that, it's difficult to comment on whether those charges, because they may use, we've seen evidence that where in the past they might have used the Offensive Behaviour Act, they've now reverted to other acts. So for instance, they might use Section 127 of the Communications Act if it's to do with the Communications Part, Section 6 of the Act. So, and we've seen evidence of them using breach of the peace as opposed to the Act. So we've seen some movement around what charges they use. So that's entirely within the gift of the police and the Procurator Fiscal Service. So it's difficult to say that a reduction in charges is evidence of anything very much.
Okay, well, fair comment. Can I just move on to the diversion from prosecution programme that was mentioned earlier? Now, there's been significant investment in that, I believe, from the Scottish Government. Why could you maybe expand on the earlier comments? Because I would be interested to know why you think that's not working.
That's not working. We don't remember this.
Well, as far as we have not had any experience of anyone who was charged under Act and then given the offer of enrolling in the SACO programme. To prevent them going through, any sort of criminal proceedings. But we did state our opposition to that particular programme just on the basis that, as Jeanette said, what we have an issue with is that we don't think that some of the things that people have been charged with actually constitute criminal behaviour. So to then try and take, again, I would assume that this is primarily aimed at young people, to take them and take them into some sort of programme and try and tell them that they're wrong and try and teach this sort of behaviour out of them, we actually think is quite a dangerous thing to do, and it's not something that we agree with at all.
I mean, on a more practical note, we think it's an enormous waste of public money to take young people in an expensive programme and in order to teach them not to swear.
Okay, it would be good to get some feedback, if we can, on exactly what the figures are with regard to any success that there has been.
Hansala, and then I'll come to the colleagues who have joined the committee this morning.
Thank you very much, Aidan, and thank you very much for your evidence this morning. I know you've been possibly put in a very difficult position one or two times, but that's part of life, I suppose, of being a minority sometimes. I know that a number of people have raised percentages. I think percentages don't mean nothing if you're a minority, because as a minority, the percentages can be so different from the everyday of the mill. If you're an indigenous community, host community, your percentages are different. If you're a minority community, those percentages can be totally different. And I think that what I've heard so far, Chair, I think that the government needs to demonstrate to all Scots, and I mean all Scots, that none of them are disadvantaged. Nobody within that community is targeted, and that everyone is entitled to equal opportunities in terms of the legislation. No one should feel that they're being intimidated by the police. No one should feel that the justice system is not clear on what charges are being laid on them and how to deal with them. I think these are all very important issues, because no one should ever feel they are not receiving justice. So that's the first point I want to make, and what I've heard so far. So what I'm getting, convener, from the evidence I've received so far, I think the government has a moral obligation to reassess the bill. I think as long as there is a community out there who feels under threat, under pressure, and intimidated, that cannot be allowed. That should not be allowed. No one in our community should feel that they are being undermined in any way. So, Karina, I feel very strongly and passionately that the government should be asked to review the bill as a matter of urgency, so that a very clear message is sent to every Scot that, yes, the government is going to review the whole act as a matter of urgency.
Jackson, before I go to colleagues, if you want to come back in.
I just want to make a clarification. I'm slightly concerned. I don't feel qualified to undertake a review of the Act this morning.
No.
And I feel that we're slightly straying into almost coming to sort of conclusive views about the effects of the Act. The petition is calling for a review to take place.
Yeah.
And I'm kind of mindful that that is where I think the balance of the discussion should be resting. This morning.
Yeah, it's asking for a review, but I think the questions have raised issues about why a review would be beneficial and why it would be necessary.
Okay.
I think we're entitled to go into that sort of territory to establish just why a review would be necessary. But I'll come to colleagues who have joined us this morning. I'll take them in the order that they were here when I arrived. So Graham, James, and then Paul.
I'm grateful, Chair. Thanks very much. And I don't intend rehearsing a great deal of the arguments that have been exchanged this morning. It's a matter of record that I've been against the legislation from the outset, and I think much of the evidence we've heard this morning would indicate why I had reservations. If I can ask a couple of questions rather than make a statement in support of the petition at this stage. The First Minister created a summit back in March 2011. The legislation was introduced in June 2011. Did either of you give any evidence, or were you involved in contributing to the debate during the period leading up to the legislation being introduced in Parliament?
Yes, I was. I was here at the Justice Committee representing the Celtic Trust, along with representatives of other football trusts from around the country, including the national team.
Okay. Yourself?
No, I wasn't myself. Okay. Fans Against Criminalisation was formed just in the immediate aftermath of that process, and we've not submitted any further evidence.
And from your own experience, did you find that the period leading up to the process of the legislation through Parliament was sufficient to allow consideration of the various views that were out there in the general population?
Well, I don't know how legislation is normally introduced and what process of consultation takes place. There were certainly a number of meetings of the Justice Committee at which people gave evidence. It wasn't clear to me that very much of that evidence, which was overwhelmingly in opposition to the Act was actually taken into account. In fact, I can think of no group other than the police who were in favour of this Act. So it didn't seem that they were taken into account. I don't know what normally happens. Certainly, I saw no evidence that the concerns that were raised by a number of groups and from a wide range of civil society were taken into account when the legislation was actually framed and passed.
And your experience of feeding into the system of government, if I can describe it in that fashion, since, where there's obviously been ongoing controversy about the existence of the legislation, do you feel that there is a process there whereby your views can be properly recorded and properly responded to?
Well, we're very grateful to have this opportunity to discuss it today. We've had other opportunities. It has been discussed elements or aspects of the operation of the Act, and things around protests against the Act have been discussed by the Justice Committee, not with our input, but certainly have been discussed. And we fully expected that when the legislation was passed and it was said that it would be reviewed after 2 years, we genuinely believed and did believe right up to the very end that that would involve a similar type of process where we would come to something like this and other people would come to something like this, a committee, and give their views on how it had worked. So we were actually really very shocked when what happened, which was simply that this document was produced, the Minister made a 10-minute statement and there was a 20-minute discussion. So no, I think at that point, I would have thought that the general public would have thought if something was going to be reviewed, there'd be an opportunity for stakeholders to have something to say about it and for there to be a consultation. And that most certainly did not happen. So we were quite shocked about that. And in fact, what seemed odd to me is that we had discussions with the leaders and representatives of all of the parties represented in the Parliament. And they all seemed to believe that that's what would happen as well. So it wasn't just the public. I mean, even the insiders seemed to believe that would happen. So it was a great shock to us to discover that we would not have any opportunity, and neither would anybody else, to say something about how this Act had played out.
Mm-hmm. You talked about the impact on the relationships between the public, in this case fans, as I've described on days of matches, and the police. Have you been able to gather what that impact actually means? Have you been able to gather statistics about the impact of this legislation on that relationship? Or is that something you've not been able to do?
That's not something we've been able to do as of yet.
I think what we have, I mean, I'm not sure what you mean by statistics on relationships, so I'm not sure how you would gather that, to be honest.
Yeah.
All that we can tell you is that in our experience, and we've had a number of very large public meetings and gatherings, we obviously get numerous emails, we have a contact form, so people get in touch with us. And in all of that, what we are hearing is that young people who go to football matches are now, now have a very negative view of the police and their role. Now, I understand the role of the police at a football match is primarily to make sure that people safely get in and safely get away. That's my understanding, and to manage the traffic. That's really what I see the police's role at a football match. Clearly, if there's any criminality of any other kind, then clearly that's their job. But by and large, as I've said before, I don't think you really observed much of that. So really that's what I think the police are there for. But our understanding now is that lots and lots of young people now have a very, very negative view of the police. And for the most part, that arises from their experience of them at football matches. Now, we know that there are other issues with police around stop and search, and that targets young people as well. But if you take that together with their experience of them at football matches, I think that's very dangerous. I think for young people not to trust the police and to have a negative view of the police and not to want to engage with the police at all is really very dangerous. And I think that's what this Act has produced.
One thing that I will say, just on that, Jeanette's obviously pointed out that we don't have any collated evidence specifically in regards that can measure that kind of thing, but there have been a few instances that have been covered by the national press in regards to police confiscating banners from young fans, stopping and searching young fans, and in some cases even verbally abusing young fans. And in quite in the cases that we've spoken to those involved, they don't want to make an official police complaint for fear of reprisal. And I think that really kind of characterises just how poisonous and just how broken down that relationship has become.
I'll give you one more.
Thank you. In addition to all the other things that have been said this morning about the possibility of a review and what that might satisfy, would it be helpful for a review to analyse, as far as possible through public opinion, the impact that the legislation has had in respect of the relationships between fans and police officers?
I would think that it would, yeah, absolutely.
I think if that's properly carried out, I think yes.
Thank you.
Paul.
Thank you, Convener. I thank the committee for the opportunity to come along this morning, and I do so to speak just briefly in favour of the petition, and I thank the petitioners for the evidence that they've submitted. I want to speak in favour of the petition on behalf of the many constituents who have contacted me in support of the petition and also with concerns about how the Act has been implemented. It's quite interesting that Mr McCaskill was sitting on this committee looking at this petition, because his department was the one that, you know, bulldozed the Act through Parliament. Back in 2011, this was a clumsy political response to a clash between football coaches at the end of an Old Firm game and the then adverse media reports that came from that. That was really what this came from. I opposed the Act at the time. I said it wasn't fit for purpose. And it's clear, looking at how things have played out and listening to the detailed evidence that the petitioners have given, that is still very much the case. As Paul Quigley says, the police already have adequate powers to deal with criminal and offensive behaviour around football grounds, and they should use those powers where appropriate. It's also clear that the Act has caused a lot of confusion amongst the judiciary in terms of interpretation. There are instances where different actions have been interpreted differently by different judges in different parts of the country, and that, you know, cannot be good at all. It's also caused, you know, divisions between football fans and police. I was also struck by what the petitioner said about the level of police scrutiny. Someone who's followed football, you know, going back to the 70s, in the 80s, when, you know, my sense is there was a lot more violence around football matches at that time. What strikes me is that we're now at a time where there's more scrutiny of football fans than ever before. And you've got to ask the question, why is that happening? I have indicated myself that I've returned to Parliament after May. I will bring forward a bill to seek to repeal this Act. I think in the meantime, the committee could take a huge step forward by supporting this petition and supporting the review, and I would urge them to do so.
Hey, thanks very much, James. Paul.
Convener, like yourself, I've been a member of the Parliament since 1999, and actually I think it needs to be recognised I've never received so many, it's unprecedented level of emails in support of a petition. And I actually think petition's very fair, because it's actually calling for a review of existing legislation, and it's put forward in a constructive and positive manner. And I actually think my experiences in dealing particularly with Jeanette Findlay, who's a local constituent, has been positive in the sense of fans against criminalisation have specific concerns in connection with legislation that's been passed by this Parliament. Clearly, as a result of the emails, correspondence, public meetings that have taken place since that Act has been passed, there are concerns out there. And I think it would be, you know, for the Parliament, it would be an opportunity for us to clearly review the legislation and do it in a way that actually recognises that there are a number of stakeholders who have a say in this. One question I wanted to ask Jeanette Findlay, though, and I know in some of the dealings I've had with Jeanette Findlay, there are specific answers to this. But the impact of this legislation is significant for those who have become involved in the judicial process, the specific individuals whose careers have been affected by the legislation and by the confusion that occurs, as James Kelly referred to, alongside the judicial process. So I wonder if Jeanette Findlay would be able to give some insight into the impact that that's had for those individuals who find themselves part of the judicial process and part of the justice system when there's been some issues concerning how that's been taken forward.
Yeah, I mean, we've already made the point that the conviction rate is not high, but in actual fact, you suffer a severe penalty just from being charged under this legislation. It's treated differently from any other act. The local fiscals don't make decisions on it. Everything has to be referred up. Everything's treated differently. All of the rules are applied very, very stringently in a way that they're not in other cases. I'll give you a very specific example. In the intermediate diet of a criminal case, sometimes the accused is given leave not to attend and their solicitor attends. And there was just such an instance in the winter of the year before last when somebody was asked to travel from Glasgow up to Dingwall, which is quite a long journey, and it was in the winter. And the fiscal insisted that they attend for the intermediate diet, which is really only where the fiscal, you know, shows the defence lawyer their evidence. So it's a very short hearing. When that individual, so they were made to travel up to Dingwall in the winter in those circumstances. When that individual came back for the full trial, there was somebody there that they were talking to who said that they were also in that position, but they had been given leave not to attend. And that person was being charged with a drugs offence. So somebody with a drugs offence was, you know, shown leniency that somebody charged under this Act was not shown by the fiscals. So that's one of the things that happens. So people have to attend very long, drawn out. Often, our experience is a minimum of 3, often 4 or 5 occasions they have to appear at court. Now, every time that happens, they have to take time off work or time off their studies. They have to often then have to, it makes it very difficult, they have to usually let their employers know what's happening. We know of numerous cases where people have lost their jobs. In some cases, not just their jobs, but their entire livelihood has been at stake, because we're talking about young people, some of whom are teachers or student teachers, some of whom are in the NHS, so they're healthcare professionals, who, if they were to have a criminal conviction, would possibly lose their registration and therefore lose their entire career. So we're talking about people who have lost jobs. We're talking about people who have had their entire career threatened after years of study and public investment. We're talking about people who have had relationships break down as a result of the stress and the pressure. They've had upsets within their family. And these are overwhelmingly, almost without exception, people who have no previous criminal convictions and who would never have been near a court. And these are not people charged with offences or acts which, you know, are at the higher, more serious end of what you might cover here. So we're not really generally talking about racism. We're not talking about homophobia. We're really not talking. We're talking about political T-shirts. We're talking about swearing. We're talking about the sort of robust language that might go on between not just football fans, but in other parts of society. So we're really not talking about something. We're often, very often, not talking about an action where there is any victim. You know, there are often no victims. Often the only victim represented in court are the police, who say they were offended. You know, the impact on people's lives, I think, the costs. Many young people who don't, because as we all know, the legal aid system is not as generous as it might once have been. So if they're in employment, not only might they risk losing their employment, and some people have lost their employment, they're having to pay, solicitor's bills. You know, you still have to pay that whether you're found guilty or not. So you could be out of pocket by the time you pay expenses and, for travelling, because often you're travelling to another part of the country. So you're having to pay expenses, you're having to pay for witnesses, you're having to pay for solicitors. Often in the region of, you know, 1,000, 2,000, we've had £4,500 bills. We had a case that concluded recently at Glasgow Sheriff Court where 7 young men spent, was it just under 2 years?
Yeah, no, it was over 2 years.
No, it was over 2 years. Over 2 years, appearing 17 times in court over singing a song over 2 years previously, and all of them got absolute discharges. A complete waste of money, lives wrecked, finances wrecked. It's an absolute disgrace.
Given that you've raised the point about the amount of effort that's made by the police and the criminal justice system to pursue these cases, how many occasions are you aware of have people who have been arrested for singing a song which is deemed to have been offensive, did the arrest take place as part of a dawn raid, where numerous police officers turn up in the early hours of the morning and take that person away, arrested for an offence which we've committed, in a football ground, but for which they were arrested later? Is that a common occurrence? Is it
that was more of an occurrence when the Act was initially brought in. At the time, the police tended to be... their approach was a bit more full-on. What often happened, what we found was happening, was that there would be simultaneous raids at usually about 7 o'clock, and it would always be on a Friday morning. And that way that people were held from the Friday until they were able to make court on the Monday over the course of the weekend. We were told, I believe, by Police Scotland that they would cease this practice, but they didn't do that. As far as we're aware, there were a few Motherwell fans, for example, who experienced similar treatment just over a month ago. So it is obviously something that's still going on. And to specifically pick a Friday morning, it seems deliberately vindictive. You know, that's not just by chance. That's a deliberate choice to do that. And again, it highlights just where the relationships broke down, just why so many young fans feel a complete distrust towards the police at the moment. And it's as Jeanette said, I think it might have actually been James Kelly, that it's in the benefit of absolutely no one that this continues.
I mean, about 6 or 7 months ago, we had a young 17-year-old Hamilton fan who had an altercation with a student, not a steward, not a physical altercation, but an exchange of words, after which he left the ground. And the following week, his mother awoke in the morning. She's a night shift worker, so she was sleeping during the day. She awoke in the morning to find 2 police officers at the foot of her bed who had come to bring her son to be charged. Now, you know, when we have police officers going to those lengths to make sure that young people are charged for really very minor activities, I think it tells you that the amount of resource and direction that's been focused on this, if focus is the right word, been focused on this this legislation and on football fans, it really does explain to you why it is that football fans are feeling so aggrieved and so discriminated against.
When we met with the interviewers for the Stirling research report, they'd obviously, by this point, already conducted interviews with, you know, various, you know, stakeholders, and that included the police at the time. And one of the interviewers actually said to us that the phrase that was used by one of the officers that was interviewed was that when the Act was first enacted, that they were approaching it with a tactic of shock and awe. As the legislation came in, to try and make an impact with a heavy-handed approach on the Act, on the assumption that this would then make fans fall in line. But much of the practices and many of the tactics that were used then can still be seen now.
I think when the Police Service of Scotland is using the phraseology and tactics of the American military, I think that does tell us we've got something to be worried about.
Yeah. Okay, I think we've had a good airing of this petition. I think Jackson and Hanzala made suggestions as to how we take it forward and ask for the Scottish Government to give their views on that review. I'm just wondering if there's a counter argument. Or Jackson, do you want to?
So I am also interested. I mean, this Parliament does have, and the petition almost sits to one side, the ability to undertake post-legislative scrutiny. Yeah. It's not just a matter for government, it's a matter for the Scottish Parliament itself. And I do wonder whether the originating committee that had responsibility for this bill, we might not write to them to understand whether or not they might be prepared within their legacy paper to recommend that this bill be the subject, this Act be the subject of a post-legislative review in the next Parliament as part of the work programme that any committee can establish for itself, in addition to any inquiry we make of the government.
Yeah, I was going to make that suggestion as well, Jackson, so I agree with that. Kenny?
I think James Kelly's made it clear it's an election issue. The Parliament's coming to the end of its term. You know, we could write to another committee, but frankly, by the time it gets there and they've concluded, they might very well even have concluded their legacy paper. It does seem to me that this is an opportunity that people will have. Mr Kelly's quite clear where he's coming from. People will have the opportunity in May to vote as they see fit. And to some extent, we should write to the government, ask for their plans. But equally, beyond that, I think it's quite clearly you're either for it or against it, and the electorate will decide.
I have to say, I tend to disagree with that. I mean, we all know there's going to be a host of issues that are going to come up in the election. I don't think we're going to have a single issue election. It's not a referendum or a judgment on the Offensive Behaviour Act. But when we do have a duty, as Jackson said, as parliamentarians, to ensure that, that legislation passed by this Parliament is fit for purpose and can be reviewed. And I tend towards that argument around this. As parliamentarians, do we want to see the legislation that's been introduced here properly reviewed and understood? And I think that's what I would be driving at, and I think why we would want to invite the Justice Committee to consider recommending a review in its legacy paper. But again, it'll be for that committee to make that decision. But I think there's no harm in this committee asking for that to be done, as it's right of us to ask the Scottish Government to comment on the arguments that have been made here this morning in terms of asking for that review to take place. Hansella?
Just as I mentioned earlier in my statement in terms of minority views are not balanced on numbers. They're balanced on principles. They're balanced on rights, human rights, legacy rights, and therefore I think it's important, the review is important, and I also giving the committee an opportunity to review that, to pass on the gauntlet to the next parliament is important. I don't believe that, you know, we play the numbers game. I think that's a dangerous game to play. I think what is more appropriate is to make sure that every person, every Scot feels that their rights are being protected, their human rights are being protected, their dignity is being protected, they are being looked after, they're part and parcel of the community, regardless of what numbers they are. I think that is just totally outrageous to suggest numbers and percentages. And I think also what's important here, convener, is that we all need to feel loved. You know, we need to know that our children are secure. We need to know that our communities are secure. We need to know that we can trust our police force. The police do a very difficult job as it is, and to complicate life for them in this way, I think, is unreasonable. I think the legislation needs to be absolutely clear. Everybody needs to have an equal right in terms of judging what is right and wrong. And I think for that purpose, I think the Act has let people down, the bill has let people down, and a review is important. So I think that writing the government and the committee is imperative. We must do that.
Okay. Angus, you want to say?
Yeah. Thanks, convener. I'm certainly keen to ask the Scottish Government to respond to the points that have been raised by the petitioners in their petition, and I'm sure that the Scottish Government will be reading the transcript word for word, if not watching it live. That's certainly a must as far as I'm concerned. However, I think we should wait for the response from the Scottish Government before we decide whether to refer it to the Justice Committee. There may be points that the government accept that will negate the need to refer it to the Justice Committee.
Yeah, I tend to take the view that the Justice Committee need to start thinking now about its legacy paper and how things get taken forward. And I think if we bring this petition to their attention, it lets them make a judgment on whether they, as a committee, and I'm not telling them what to do, but if we don't bring it to their attention now, the legacy papers would be completed possibly before the Scottish Government responded. Jackson?
So I wasn't proposing to refer it to the Justice Committee. I was proposing to make an inquiry of the Justice Committee. And as a counterpoint, Mr McCaskill, there's views I respect. I've actually spent, I think it's true, saying more minutes discussing this issue this morning than I have in my lifetime spent watching football, such is my interest in the sport. I don't have a preconceived notion. I did vote against the legislation at point, but what's been called for here is a review, And I think I was keen to say in the questions that I put to the witnesses that I wasn't prejudging in my own mind what the outcome of that review would be, but I thought that the petition and the evidence that we've heard has supported the case for a post-legislative review, which in any event I think this Parliament should be undertaking more as a matter of routine, particularly on legislation which has been designed to change social attitude.
Kenny, you wanted to come back.
It seems to me that the Justice Committee are going to be doing their legacy paper. This has hardly been something that is unknown to them. It is something that is well within their cognizance. It's something that has been written to them, and it seems to me that if they wish to pursue it, then you know they will do so. So I don't see any requirement for us to be making any recommendation or referral to them, because when they look back over the Parliament from 2011 to 2016, you know, it's one of the foremost pieces of legislation that has been before them.
Okay, I've got to try and, in this capacity, to try and reach a consensus so that we don't divide unnecessarily. So I'll ask you directly, Kenny, do you object to the committee raising this petition, advising the Justice Committee that this petition exists and bringing it to their attention? Because that basically is all that's been asked.
I don't object to it on the basis that it's within their knowledge, but, you know, I'm perfectly comfortable as long as we're not making a recommendation. But I think we could say that we had witnesses before us, and doubtless they will be considering and their own views can be formed.
Okay. In that case, it appears as though we've got a consensus that we write to the government asking for their views on the request for a review and the comments that have been made this morning, and we draw the petition to the attention of the Justice Committee.
Is that okay? And as well as to whether they have any comments on matters made, that they're not here to rebut any of the issues. They're distinct and separate from the government, and they may wish to have a view.
I have no issue with that whatsoever, given the fact that the chief officer who was involved at the time is no longer there. We may have a fresh look at it from the Police Scotland point of view, which I personally would welcome, given that the discussions I had with the former Chief Constable of Scotland led me to believe that neither did he understand the issue, he didn't want to understand the issue, and that his arrogance, narcissism and authoritarianism were what drove him towards supporting the introduction of this legislation in the first place. So a fresh look at that from the new Chief Constable would probably be beneficial as well. So if we write to those organisations in that manner, then I think we look forward to their responses. Thanks very much, Mr. Quigley and Ms. Findlay, for coming before us this morning. We'll obviously update you on the responses that we get, but thanks for bringing your petition to us. And I'll suspend for a couple of minutes to allow the witnesses to change. Next petition this morning is PE1594 by Richard Burton on behalf of Accountability Scotland on the specification of lying as an example of public maladministration. Members have a note from the clerk, the petition itself and the spice briefing. Any members have any comments to make on it? I'm sure we all agree we deprecate lying, but it would be useful to, as a starting point, to find out in terms of the Parliament and Government what the views of the Scottish Government are in relation to this. I don't know that there's much more we can do to... Yeah. Everybody agree we write to the Government, just ask them to give us a perspective on it.
I have to say I'm querulous about it, but in this, I think similar to the SPSO, given their references, to have the right to respond.
Yes. Yeah. I think we do that then. We write to the Scottish Government and the SPSO and ask them to comment on the petition and take it forward, and then we'll let the petitioner know what the views are when we get them back. And that brings us to agenda item 3. Our next item of business is consideration of 11 continued petitions. The first petition is PE1319 by William Smith and Scott Robertson on improving youth football in Scotland. Again, members have information that has been brought to them by the clerk and the submissions that we received back. Members have a view. Angus?
Yeah, thanks, Commissioner. I'd certainly be keen to hear the response from the Commissioner for Children and Young People in response to the SFA, SPFL view. And the intended actions that have been set out in their response.
Yeah, I think it would be useful to know that. Yeah, okay. We can continue on that basis. Okay. Our next petition, PE1477, by Jamie Ray on behalf of the Throat Cancer Foundation on a gender-neutral HPV vaccination. Members have a note from the clerk. But I should point out the petitioners contacted the clerks yesterday afternoon asking that the committee defer consideration of this petition to its next meeting. This is to allow them to write to the committee in more depth. I understand that petitioners would like to raise two concerns with the committee. Firstly, the length of time the JCVI is taking to issue guidance on this matter, and secondly, the proposed HPV vaccine programme is not wide enough in its scope. So,
happy to hear it.
Angus?
Yeah, I think the petitioners may well have some valid points, and it would be good to get more detail from them in due course. So I'd certainly be keen to keep it open until we get further information.
Yeah, I think that's agreed by the members. Okay, and we'll have that on our next committee meeting then, and that will give the petitioners time to get back to us. Our next petition, PE1545, by Anne Maxwell on behalf of the Muir Maxwell Trust on residential care provision for the severely learning disabled. Again, members have a note from the clerk plus the submissions that we received back. I don't know that we can do much with it, but it's whether we close it or is there still, because of some of the responses, enough scope to leave it open and allow a future committee to have a look to see if there's anything that comes out of the deliberations. I'm always reluctant to close petitions if there's still some work around it. It might be that a new committee would look at it and say, no, there's nowhere we can go with this. But given that there are still some issues that are outstanding, should we leave it open and just add it in their legacy paper? Happy with that?
I'm fine with that.
Okay. Next petition, PE1555 by Siobhan Garrahy on electric shock and vibration collars for animals. Again, what do members think? Is there any mileage in keeping this open, or we got the answers that we're going to get? I think so. Yeah.
Convener, given that the Scottish Government has said they are reviewing the current situation, the current law, I don't think there's much more this petition committee can do.
Yeah, I think so. As I said, I'm always reluctant to close them when there's still reviews, but I think the government's made it clear exactly what the outcome it's looking for, so yeah. There's not much more we can do with it. Okay, so we'll close that one. Next petition, PE1561 by Karen Gray on behalf of Rabbits Require Rights Scotland on pet rabbit welfare. Members have a view on how we deal with this?
Yeah.
The only thing we could do is ask them to speed it up, but I don't know that would make any difference in the long run. Yeah. So we close this petition.
I think the committee's taken it as far as it
yeah, thanks.
Can be known.
Okay, next petition, PE1572 by Parveen Hack on occupational disclosure in trials and sentencing. Again, members have notes and the submissions that have been received. Pretty comprehensive responses, I thought. Yes. They basically answer the questions that were put. There's not much... I think we can close this one and advise the petitioner. The next petition, PE1573 by Jordan Daly on behalf of TIE, Time for Inclusive Education, on statutory teaching of LGBTI plus issues. I mean, I think it was said at the time, although there was a lot of sympathy for the petition itself, when you're asking to set in stone something in the curriculum, it's not a thing that happens as such, but I think the issues that were raised and the fact that the committee took it forward and asked for such a comprehensive analysis of the situation, I think the responses were positive, but I don't think we can actually ask the government to do what the petitioner asked, which was to set something in the curriculum and force local authorities, education authorities and teachers to teach it in the way that they were asking. But I think they might understand that, actually. But I think they raised a very important issue. But I don't think there's anything more we can do with the petition. Members agree?
Agreed.
Okay. Our next petition is PE1574 by Frieda Birrell on behalf of the UK Association of HPV Vaccine Injured Daughters on HPV vaccine safety. Again, we've got the submissions back.
Convener, I think you should close the under rule 15.71, considering the European Commission is looking at it and all these have bearings on Scotland.
Yeah. Members agree with that? Yeah. Our next petition is PE1576 by Owen Martin on blue badges for children with autism and Down syndrome. Again, we've had the submissions back, but I think they're a pretty comprehensive response. So under Rule 1572 of Standing Orders, we might want to close it.
Game, and if it doesn't work out to be satisfactory, isn't taken further, then to some extent it would be grounds for a new petition, and the ground's changing under our feet. I think we've done all we can.
Okay, so we agree to close it on that basis. Our next petition, PE1577 by Rachel Wallace on adult cerebral palsy services. Murdo Fraser's joined us now to talk to her. Do you want to make some comments, Murdo, before we consider anything you want to bring to our attention or raise with us before we deliberate on?
Thank you, Convener. Thanks for the opportunity to say a few words. I was very pleased to support Rachel when she came previously to the committee, and I think if I recall that session, members were impressed with the evidence she gave. We've had responses back from the Scottish Government, from Capability Scotland, who've been very supportive of the petition, and from the petitioner herself. In relation to the Scottish Government's response, they have suggested a meeting between the petitioner and the minister, and that would be very welcome. I tried on a number of occasions, members might recall, previously to get a meeting. I'm pleased that's been offered, and I think we'd be happy to take that up. I'm not aware of the minister's office having been in touch to arrange that as yet, but I think I'd be keen to pursue that. But I wonder really whether a private meeting between the petitioner and the minister is sufficient in this case, given that there are much broader issues that are being raised in the petition, and there is an impact on a whole range of adults other than simply the petitioner herself. So while I think Rachel Wallace and myself would be pleased to have a meeting with the minister, I wouldn't like that to be seen to be the sole outcome of this particular petition, and I would encourage the committee members to consider what further action they might want to take to pursue this, and whether, for example, they might feel it appropriate to ask the minister to come before the committee to answer some of the questions that were raised both in the original petition and in the very detailed response that's now come in from Capability Scotland.
Colleagues?
Murdo's concerns. I think that's right, because the issue is significant and important. I mean, it might be prelude to more than just a meeting, but where the government's going. But the first response, rather than getting the minister here, given the time's tight, would be to just ask the government, one, will they confirm the meeting? And then two, after the meeting, to perhaps give us an indication of the outcome. Because until then, I think we would be prejudging it. But to ask the minister to both meet and return to us, hopefully expeditiously before...
Yeah, but I think we do have to pursue this a bit further. I think we need to clarify whether the meeting's going to take place. I think that's a legitimate request. But we also need to know from the government what they want to do in terms of taking it forward as a clinical pathway, because that's what's been asked here. And I'm not sure that we've got that answer yet. But we could write to the government on that basis to get a confirmation of the meeting, but also to ask them specifically about the clinical pathway. Is that right? Okay.
Yeah.
And we'll take it forward in that manner. But thanks, Murdo, for bringing that to your attention. Okay, the final continued petition is PE1580 by Sheila Duffy on behalf of Ash Scotland on guidance for Parliament staff on international health treaty standards. I think, yeah, we did get some additional information. Members have on their desk a submission that's been received from the World Health Organization in response to the committee's request for examples of good practice in other legislatures. Who has provided examples of practice in governments and government departments in various countries, and who states that the examples provided are generally more advanced as they concern government officials and government bodies, and goes on to say that the equivalent practices for legislative bodies are in the process of being developed in some countries. So, I mean, I think this is an issue that the Scottish Parliament had already looked at, and I think it's something that, if it is being taken forward by WHO and there are other countries looking at this, I'm sure the Scottish Parliament would be party to any outcomes that would emerge if there were any issues that need to be addressed in the way that the Parliament deals with the tobacco companies. So I have to say, I feel as though we've achieved all we're going to achieve through this. We've identified all the information that we need, and we should close this petition. But Angus, I would
agree, Convener. I think I'm content with the response that we've received from the presiding officer, assuring us that the FCTC guidelines are being followed. So, content to close the petition.
Yeah, I agree with that. Okay, so that brings us to the end of considerations of petitions, and we now go into private session as agreed earlier in the meeting. Thank you.